would be great. Thank you. Thank you. Great. Okay. Well, thank you. Welcome, everybody, for this hearing on H.808, as well as the general concept of use of force. So thank you, and I want to thank Government Operations for being here and joining us. I know that that your committee is doing quite a bit of work on this already, and so I think it's important that we both hear this testimony together.
So thank both committees for being here and for the folks who are here to share their viewpoints with us. These two bills are interrelated and have been assigned to two different committees, so we felt it was really important to spend some time this afternoon really getting a 360-degree view of some of these issues, hearing from as many perspectives as possible. I think the first perspective that we would like to hear from this afternoon is from the author of the bill that is in the Judiciary Committee. So Representative Ann Donahue, if you want to join us and share with us a few minutes of your thoughts on why you put this idea forward.
Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm Representative Ann Donahue, and I really want to just give a brief overview of where it came from. I've followed, you know, with the same concern that I think many citizens have when there are situations where there's a death that results from the use of lethal force, but especially in mental health situations, because that's the community that I'm a part of. When people are in a mental health crisis, and there's been a really significant increase in those deaths in the past 4 or 5 years. And there often seems to be a real perception about accountability. And I think the issue is public confidence, or particularly confidence on the part of members of minority communities like my own. Part of that is just a lack of public understanding about what the standard is for the use of force, that it's the situation kind of right at the moment without a broader context. So people hear about something and they hear, well, there was a thumbs up, thumbs down, it was justified. But gee, we thought there was more to it than that. I want to make clear this is not based on a sense that there is inappropriate use of force in Vermont. I think we have a very high standard of professionalism. But it is about the importance of public transparency and public confidence in the system of how we review those situations when they occur. So this is something that's been on my mind for a while, but last spring, I saw news reports about the new law that was passed in California that did take a little bit of that broader look about, you know, is force really the only option or necessary? What's the slightly broader context? And it seemed to me like a really good place for discussion here in Vermont. So I worked primarily with Representative Jessup, who was sort of co-sponsored with me, asking for a bill to be drafted. And it was only at that point that I learned from legislative counsel that we didn't actually have a current statutory standard that was a statewide standard on use of force. Surprised me because I had been involved in the bill regarding use of tasers some years back. And so we have one for tasers, but not for use of lethal force. So we brought this bill forward really for two reasons. One, to encourage the adoption of a statewide statutory standard, and second, to encourage that the California law be the basis for discussion about what those standards should be. Might not be that those standards are exactly what's right for Vermont, but I think it's a good starting point. We simply asked legislative counsel to draft what passed in California as a draft. It's not to say this is exactly right or this language is the language that should be followed, but it seemed like a really good base for looking at the issue. And the purpose is pretty straightforward. It's to increase transparency and public process, public confidence, I'm sorry, in that review process, both by having a really well-articulated standard for accountability and one that includes the logical context of a situation when it occurs. So I appreciate your hearing testimony and hearing different perspectives on where Vermont should be.
Great. Thank you. Thank you so
Bryn? So Bryn Hare from Legislative Council, and because there are two different bills, one that has been referred to Government Operations and the other to the Judiciary Committee, I've asked Legislative Council to prepare a comparison of the two bills. So thank you.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, committees. For the record, Bryn here from Legislative Council. And I appreciate that introduction that the sponsor of H808 just provided. That gives me a good entryway here. I think that one of the committee assistants just passed out a real high-level summary of these two bills. Given the number of witnesses that you have to hear from today and the time that you have allotted, I'm not going to do a line-by-line walkthrough of these bills. Rather, I'm going to talk sort of generally about what each of them do, and hopefully the high-end summary will give you a little framework. So, as the chair has just indicated, both bills address law enforcement policies that govern the use of force in policing. H-464, which is in the Government Operations Committee, requires that stakeholders create a policy that encompasses law enforcement use of force. And H-808, which is in the Judiciary Committee, sets out, as the sponsor just indicated, a statewide policy that governs the use of deadly force. So the bills do this in two different ways. So 464, and I set it up section by section here, it requires that law enforcement collect data about any use of force that's employed during a roadside stop. And it also updates the existing statutes on law enforcement data collection to require the involvement of the Executive Director of Racial Equity. Section 2 is the section that deals with the policy, the use of force policy. So it requires that the Criminal Justice Training Council and others create a model policy that deals with the appropriate use of force, de-escalation tactics, and cross-cultural awareness. And then it imposes requirements that are similar to the requirements that both these committees are familiar with about fair and impartial policing, how that policy is adopted, how it's updated, what the training requirements are. And then it also requires that the council report regularly to the General Assembly on whether or not policies have been adopted and law enforcement officers have been trained. And lastly, it requires 4 hours of training as a part of basic training on the new policy regarding use of force. H-808 does things a little differently. It creates a statutory statewide policy regarding the use of deadly force. So it sets it out in law what the policy is. And that policy provides that the allowable use of deadly force is limited to situations when it is necessary in defense of human life. It doesn't impose training requirements on law enforcement, and it doesn't impose sanctions on law enforcement for violating the policy. Those were not contemplated in the creation of the bill, as I think the sponsor just indicated. So I did want to point out, though, that statutory policy can be used in a court or by an investigative body in determining whether or not a law enforcement officer, whether or not their actions were appropriate in a given situation.
Thank you. Any questions for Bryn in terms of the two bills?
I was wondering if you could dive a bit deeper into the main difference as it relates to California and Vermont, because I know it comes from the wording, whether it's reasonable versus necessary. I was wondering if you could further define those words and their differences as it relates to the law.
So do you mean the difference between Vermont, the way Vermont has handled it and the way California has handled it, or rather the reasonable person standard?
Well, it's my understanding California changed it to the necessary standard, and that's what we're looking to change it to potentially. And I was wondering if you could get into the definition of necessary versus reasonable and how they differ.
Right, so both the, so H.808 really draws on both that necessary standard. The necessary is sort of a threshold standard, and I can point you to the language in the bill, which is on page 2, subdivision B2. This is the language that provides that law enforcement may only use deadly force when necessary in defense of human life. The remainder of the policy talks more about a reasonable person standard. It talks about how law enforcement, in determining whether law enforcement's actions were necessary in defense of human life, it draws on the reasonable person standard. Did that officer act in an objectively reasonable manner in making a determination about whether his or her actions were in defense of human life? So I would say it really draws on both. The threshold standard is the necessary standard, but that standard is determined by whether or not that officer acted in a reasonable manner.
Thanks.
So it does, I'm a little confused, I'm going to straighten it out. So does California follow the standard, the threshold standard?
Yes, this is so.
To basically word for word, not word for word, but.
Yeah, so this is modeled on the California statute.
Okay.
And it's a little bit different because the California statute does have additional language beyond just this, which imposes penalties on law enforcement if they do violate the policy. So, but yes, the California language does rely on that.
Okay, so Vermont doesn't follow California?
No, like as I just mentioned.
I'm just confused because when Representative Donahue was speaking, she said, I maybe she didn't say, but I took it as we followed California.
That's what H.808 does, is it follows California.
But what's the difference?
Only in that it doesn't, that it sets forth the statewide policy, but it doesn't also, in addition, impose those penalties for a violation of the policy.
Can you just help me understand the California bill? This is based on the California bill as passed.
Yes.
The California bill is introduced, does that have a higher standard than the reasonable person standard?
As it was introduced, it looked very different. I would not be able to tell you with certainty right now what those differences were, but I do believe it had a higher standard than it wound up with.
Okay.
And I can get you the version as it was introduced.
Okay.
Thank you.
I don't know if this probably isn't even for you, Brent, but so law enforcement is having more contact with people with mental health issues more often. So I guess it's more of a statement. Is that the problem, or is the problem with the system with people with mental health issues? I guess that's more to be revealed.
Yes, I think so.
Question for a witness, perhaps.
Right. Yeah.
Response.
Okay.
For the record, I can't stay longer, so if you want to do a different order of operation,
Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Michael Sherling, the Commissioner of Public Safety for the last few months. There's an enormous amount to say on this particular topic, so I'm going to confine things to giving you a brief overview of the existing state of process, speak a little bit about the challenges that have emerged over the last decade or so, and give you a little preview about the things that we're working on right now that in part address some of the concerns that this bill is drafted to address. Let me start by saying there's no cross section of Vermonters that is as acutely aware as the community that's impacted by this, the mental health community, as law enforcement. Instances where lethal force are used, whether it's an instance where it's someone suffers from a mental illness or any other instance, are incredibly devastating events for all involved. So this is an area where we've got tremendous interest in improving outcomes. The challenge that you're facing is one that's not endemic to Vermont, something that is happening on a national level. But before I get to that, let me just give you some sense of the thinking that goes into the way we operate in contemporary law enforcement here in Vermont in the 21st century. Our law enforcement agencies, whether they're state, county, or local, are consistently involved in an ongoing continuous improvement process on a host of topics. The operating landscape is increasingly complex every year, whether it's related to use of force, search and seizure, the types of tools that are necessary, the threats that are faced, frankly, on the street on any given day. The operating environment gets more complex every year. So as a result of that, and because it is the right thing to do, we've got organizations that are constantly looking for the next best way of doing business. And we do that with an eye toward five key things that make successful organizations. Good hiring, which is, of course, is a challenge. We'll save that for another day. Training, policy development, supervision, data and data-driven analysis of what's going on to ensure that we're getting the right outcomes, and then leadership, which intersects all of those things. So we have an eye toward a variety of things to get good outcomes for Vermonters. There is a robust amount of training and policy development that happens on a day-to-day basis. It's a constant iterative process. Our policies that are in place in almost every area of Vermont, I can't speak to every specific department, but in all the ones that I'm aware of, are contemporary. They follow the models that are put forth either under accreditation standards by the Commission on Law Enforcement Accreditation, the International Association of Chiefs of Police, the Police Executive Research Forum, a variety of high-end think tank organizations that help to craft these policies to work on a national basis. Use of force is a constitutional standard. It flows from the Fourth Amendment of the Constitution. The use of force on someone that we're arresting, whether it's at a low level or a high level, like lethal force, is governed by the Fourth Amendment. It is the seizure of a person. There is an almost indescribable amount of case law that flows from the Fourth Amendment that's been interpreted now for more than five decades by the courts that very specifically guides the way law enforcement officers across the nation, including Vermont, employ force. It's a very well-formed area of the law. The only state that we're aware of that has differed from the constitutional standards set by the Supreme Court is California, which has created a statutory construct, the outcome of which is unknown because it is relatively new. Shifting gears a bit, the types of things we're trying to prevent, the use of deadly force and or the ugly events that are part of the policing environment, unfortunately by default, because we're the last line of defense when things are not going well in any particular scenario. There isn't anybody else to call. So some of the things that happen are relatively ugly. Most of those things, even when they're disheartening to see on a videotape or described in a witness interview, are handled pursuant to the law and with great professionalism. There is a cross-section like in any other business that involves humans where there are errors made, and occasionally, there is malicious intent to the types of things that happen. But to give you a sense of the volume, you all know the kinds of things that make headlines that are those events that go sideways and have poor outcomes. But to give you a sense of what that sets against, there are hundreds of thousands of interactions between police officers and the public in Vermont every year. A very small cross-section of them result in the use of any kind of force, and a very small cross-section of those that result in the use of force result in the use of deadly force. Those numbers can be typically measured on one hand, occasionally two hands in Vermont in a given year, set against hundreds of thousands of interactions. That's not to diminish the importance or the severity or the impact of a very small number of things. They are still very impactful to families, to communities, to the officers that are involved, but it's just to give you a sense of how frequent these kinds of events are. The goal, of course, is to get to zero. Now narrowing the focus a little bit to interactions with folks that are suffering from some type of mental health crisis. It is no secret that the numbers of interactions between law enforcement and the criminal justice system more broadly, in some cases that's corrections and other components of the system, not only in Vermont, but nationally, have increased exponentially, hundreds of percent over the last decade. as a result of a variety of factors. But the core component is what I believe was a well-intentioned public policy instituted now 50 years ago, deinstitutionalization, but poorly executed. It was a failed promise on the part of government nationally to replace institutionalization with field-level mental health assistance and a variety of approaches using a continuum to help people who were in crisis at various stages. We took the cost savings, but we didn't actually implement the back end of what was promised 50 years ago. And as a result, we've seen an increasing deterioration of conditions on the street for people suffering from crisis and an inability to respond to the volume of cases that are presented. And if the artificial construct that I've developed to describe this is, if you look at the mental health continuum of response in four components, at tier one, you have folks that, by virtue of their circumstance, require long-term, secure kinds of placements, relatively low number of people, but they exist. At tier two, you have folks that might require in-hospital assessment for a short period of time, but need a bed for a period of time. At level three, you have folks that require some kind of, what I've heard clinicians refer to in an informal way as a tune-up. They require a crisis bed, we typically think of them as 1 or 2 days of assistance in a facility where they can get more intense services. And then tier four, I'm sort of oversimplifying this, folks that are perfectly fine in the community, they just engage with services on an ongoing basis. The problem is we have such limited capacity at the top end of the system that folks that need those services are cascading all the way through the remainder of the system. Emblematic of that is the increase in the number of folks that are either getting rides to the hospital in the back of an ambulance or presenting themselves in emergency departments and have multiple week, in some cases, stays awaiting a more secure placement bed for them to get assistance. And the number of emergency responses on the part of law enforcement that are going to these events. So that is not the responsibility of anyone at the currently at the Department of Mental Health, and it's not endemic to Vermont. It is something that's happening on a national level, and the resources and the tools to create an effective abatement strategy have been elusive for all of us on a national level. Should also note for the record that as we're talking about the intersection of law enforcement and folks that are suffering with some kind of a mental illness, that should not be seen as any kind of a badge of shame on the part of the folks that are suffering with this illness. One of our fundamental problems is for some reason we bifurcate an illness that is mental health in nature from illness that is physical in nature. Imagine for a moment you walked into an emergency department and you were told or you had to sit in a bed for 33 days awaiting assistance for a heart ailment. We would be up in arms instantaneously, but that unfortunately is what repeats itself in Vermont and throughout the country with folks that are suffering with an illness that's often less tangible for people. So, important side note. So all of that is to set up this. When things cascade out of control and someone is unable to access the requisite level of treatment that they need or the basic assistance, it may not even be treatment, it may just be the ability to see someone at a time they're having a crisis. And things continue to, what's referred to in mental health world as decompensate. They continue to get worse. Imagine the physical side of things. You have a severe laceration that requires some kind of intervention, but you're unable to do anything with it. It continues to get worse and worse, eventually gets infected, and things are going very poorly. Same general analogy. You're unable to access the treatment you need at the time you need it. You continue to decompensate, and at some point, with a very small number of people, but with some cross-section, they're now in a scenario where they pose a danger to themselves or others. And we're forced to bring, in many instances, the wrong tool to bear. And at the time when this crisis is emerging, some of the things you've seen as front page news, it wouldn't actually matter who you put at the scene, because things have gone so badly, we could send a team of psychiatrists to the scene, and they would be unable, because of the level of deterioration that's happened, to make any significant impact with that person because they're acting out in a violent way, or more often, they're actually in a scenario where they want the responders to do something to them that takes their life, what we call suicide by cop, which is unfortunately a fairly common thing that happens in the United States and in Vermont. So the goal is, through our lens, is to create a continuum of response to both public safety and public health that addresses things at the lowest possible level. So we've developed a multi-phase modernization strategy for public safety. One piece of that strategy is to develop this construct and to develop the tools necessary to ensure that we're putting the right resources on the scene at the right time. And it's everything from prevention and education. Preventing things from happening is the best dollar invested. Again, to use a medical analogy, if you can prevent illness or injury, it's far less expensive and far more effective. The next level is outreach and intervention, going out and providing services at that low level, what I described as the fourth bucket, field level street outreach intervention, those kinds of response methodologies to help people at the lowest possible level fix whatever the issue is. At the next level, alternative sanctions, this is really more criminal justice, but our restorative justice models and things like that can get people onto off-ramps from traditional courts and corrections and or the mental health system. And then finally, having enough capacity at the back end of the system for those who unfortunately need the beds to be able to get them in there as quickly as possible, because the quicker you provide the treatment, and I'll let physicians speak to this in greater depth, or healthcare professionals speak to this in greater depth, but just like an injury, the quicker you're able to provide the requisite treatment, the less impactful the stay is, and the less impactful the illness or injury can be. So that's the general overview. What you will hear next is a more in-depth analysis or picture painted of what we do around training, around policy development, and sort of the nuts and bolts of what happens. But I want to be really clear. We've spent a lot of time in the last decade talking about how we train law enforcement officers at a higher level to respond to mental health. We have tweaked use of force policies to ensure that they are as contemporary as possible. In many instances, we are looking in the wrong place. The correct answer, I believe, is to put different resources onto the problem earlier in the process. That is what's going to change the outcomes. And to that end, part of what we've proposed during this budget cycle is for a partnership between the Department of Public Safety, the Department of Mental Health, and the Department of Corrections to pool resources to expand statewide the street outreach intervention, the social worker model that we have in two barracks that is actively in place in Chittenden County, and there are a number of other departments around Vermont. Actually, I should give kudos to Bellows Falls, who was the first one in Vermont to have an embedded social worker within their police department. We believe that that alteration to the response methodology is the right answer. It's the right investment. It fits in the continuum of approach that we're suggesting is the right way to approach all of these issues. And simultaneously, we're working on a variety of other efforts around data, improving our data systems so that we can help you and help ourselves make long-term better policy and better strategy on these complicated issues. I could go on for about 6 more hours, but that's I'll get out of the way and let some other folks talk.
Oh, thank you. And this certainly isn't the only time we'll be having this conversation. It's really the very beginning of the conversation. So, yeah.
Sorry.
Mr. Sherling, thank you for your elaborate testimony and your leadership. You talked about continuous improvement process and how that can improve outcomes. So how does that process include input from the community?
It varies. It's a great question. It varies on a case-by-case basis based on the size of the department. But actually some of the most, you'd think the larger the department, the more robust the community engagement efforts would be. But actually some of the smaller departments are the ones sometimes we're following. It ranges from everything from community academies, where you're getting people in and both training them how law enforcement operations work and simultaneously getting feedback, community meetings on a variety of topics. In some instances, when policy is developed, you have the folks within agencies that are developing policy that are doing outreach to community groups and stakeholders to help inform how that policy is crafted. There's probably 10 others that I'm not remembering off the top of my head. I know the Grand Isle Sheriff has some youth engagement efforts that he has done. He does a community barbecue every year where they engage people on a host of topics. The types of strategies are as varied as the Vermont communities, which is good.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
Nice to see you. And I think what I heard implicit in your testimony is maybe not support for either of these bills, but a wholesale different approach, and I don't want to walk away with the wrong impression if that's how.
I think that is correct. It is the. So I would advise two things at this point. A, let's hold fast and see what happens in California, because they have completely broken the glass on 50 years of case law relative to this topic. And we don't know what's going to happen. So let's see. More important than that, I think if we're trying to get a handle on how to have better outcomes on this particular topic, that the first place to look for our effort and investment is in alternative response methodologies and making investments, policy decisions, and pushing ourselves and our communities to embrace that model as quickly and effectively as possible.
Just a follow-up to that, so do you see any room for or possible proposals around improvements regarding use of force policies or definitions or
yes.
Statutory provisions as they relate to policing?
That's a great question. I think on our, and it's been distributed to some of the committees represented here, but on our website, the media will be able to read it and the public as well, dps.vermont.gov/modernization. Is the modernization strategy. Among the things that we think are sort of first order of operation, in addition to the mental health response, which is embedded there, is improving our data collection system so that we can better inform how we make policy, and modernizing our training methodology. To that end, you have created the Law Enforcement Advisory Board, which has wide representation, including law enforcement professionals, the Attorney General, the Defender General. It's 24 VSA 1939. It's designed to advise me, the Governor, and the General Assembly, in part on law enforcement policy. I think where I would tend to go with this is to ask the LEAB not only to give recommendations on any requisite improvements to use of force policy, but also to take a look at training, not just in use of force, but I do believe, and I've had this conversation with the Criminal Justice Training Council and stakeholders over the first few months of my tenure here, I believe the model, the content of the training we provide is exceptional. But we have room to improve the delivery mechanisms and modernize those so that we get better outcomes. Using technology, looking at different ways of doing both our basic, intermediate, and advanced policing training. So I think there are ways that we can make improvements and leverage the great content that we've already got, which you're going to hear about in a few minutes, by improving the systems of delivery. Same thing with the data systems. I observe in my first 5 months at Public Safety, you've got exceptional product that is being delivered by the State Police, Emergency Management, Fire Safety, the Lab, Vermont Crime Information Center, despite the fact that there are some foundational difficulties We have some budgetary difficulties. We've got data system difficulties. We've got ways we can modernize the way that we share equipment in public safety. All of this is embedded in this construct of public safety modernization that we're pointing you to now and that we've been testifying about in various committees for a couple of weeks. Sorry if I went far afield with your question, but there's a lot here.
Thanks for coming in. Being from Windham County, I'm well aware of how effective it was that Clark first embedded a social worker in the Bellas Falls Police Department. I think arrests went down 50% because of that. Are we seeing those kind of outcomes embedding social workers in the state police barracks?
We are. We're seeing contact with the folks that are frequently on the radar for a variety of reasons. It's not always mental health. It might be substance abuse. It often is co-occurring disorders. We're seeing those numbers go down. In Burlington, this operating methodology has been in place for 2 decades now, starting with one person on one street, expanding to now 2 teams of 9 people. And the contact with the folks who find themselves intersecting not only law enforcement resources, but emergency department, other field mental health resources, a variety of systems goes down. And as a result, the outcomes improve primarily for that person, which is incredibly impactful. But then the costs actually go down for folks in the system. There's a 1980s article called Million Dollar Murray that was written by Malcolm Gladwell. It was an assessment of a single person in New York who suffered from multiple disorders and intersected multiple systems. And at the time in the 80s, the assessment was he was a million-dollar person to various systems because no one took ownership and tried to assist Murray at using wraparound services, as we call it today. I would submit to you today that there are multiple multi-million dollar people in our communities because we haven't solved this problem. And it's not their fault. We're actually doing them a disservice by not providing the right resources at the right time. I'm trying to get out of here.
So you said that the California statute broke 50 years of case law. So are you
It broke a tradition with the 50 years of case law. It's the first one to break the glass and not follow Graham v. Connors, the core piece of case law, and then multiple cases that flow from that.
So are you saying it's unconstitutional?
I'm not. I'm saying let's wait and see what it looks like.
Okay. Thank you.
You probably already said, how long ago did California?
It just took effect, I believe, in January. July. I'm just back in the game. I was on the sideline.
The reason I asked is because a couple of years ago in the building we started doing a lot of legislating around results-based accountability. And to change to that, we don't have the results to change that like we've tried to do with most everything. But, with your testimony, and it's just what I'm hearing. I was on human services my first 4 years here, and of course, not knowing where you were going with your testimony, you're talking a lot about. Over half of what you're talking about was mental health issues, and I guess going forward, I would hope at some point that if this bill, these bills, whether they're combined or continue to go forward, that you would get in front of the Human Services Committee, because without the mental health talking, I would see it as that part of being out of our jurisdiction as far as our 2 committees go, which just makes sense to me.
We'll be there upon invitation, and we're actively working with Commissioner Squirrel, Secretary Smith, Acting Commissioner Baker on these issues as well. I should also note, for the record, that recently completed work by the Council of State Governments on justice reinvestment and the construct for this continuum that we're talking about in modernization dovetails perfectly with the work that they've just completed and some of the suggestions they have on how we can move forward for better outcomes across the entire spectrum of the system.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. Attorney General? afternoon. Welcome.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Thank you, Governor, Vermont Attorney General. I want to thank both committees for taking this bill up, and I want to particularly thank Representative Donahue for introducing this bill. Representative Donahue and I have had many conversations about this issue, and I truly appreciate her advocacy. I fully support this conversation. And this conversation is not just about public safety. This conversation is about public trust in law enforcement. And this is why we need to have this conversation. I also want to say that the police have an incredibly difficult job, and the police do an extremely good job in the state of Vermont. And this conversation should not be about who's doing something wrong. This conversation should be about what can we do better to have a 21st century law enforcement system and services, which encompasses many of the things that Commissioner Shirley just talked about in the state of Vermont. Training is a big piece of that. Mental illness is a big piece of that. Recognizing disabilities and understanding disabilities is a big piece of that. Being culturally competent is a big piece of that. And we've asked the police to do a tremendous amount, and we have to make sure that we're providing them the adequate resources and training in order to confront these complex challenges. But I come to this conversation in my role as a prosecutor who reviews Officer Mall shootings. And the vast majority are justified. Those are my rulings, based on the facts and based on the legal standard. But I don't think anybody thinks that an outcome that results in the death of somebody is a good outcome. And that's our challenge. And so having this conversation about the requisite training, the appropriate standard, and looking at California and learning from California, we should do. We absolutely should do. And anytime I talk about these issues, I think about some of the cases and some of the decisions I made. The one that always comes to my mind is the Phil Grennan case, which was in Burlington, where he was a 77-year-old man in his apartment on College Street. And he was in a mental health crisis. He was shot and killed, and I ruled that justified. And it was justified, in my opinion, under the current standard. But if we look at the totality of circumstances of when it is necessary, the question about what's necessary, let's be very clear, that's not defined yet. That's part of the issue here. We need to talk to California and talk to the Assistant Attorney General who worked on this. He's willing to testify to this committee, and I would urge you to have him appear, and I'm happy to help facilitate that. But we should explore this conversation of the legal standard, understanding the consequences, understanding the unintended consequences, and be deliberate about this, because this is about public trust at the end of the day. I can recall talking to parents of an individual who was shot and killed. And will that justify? And one of the things I try to do is to, before I make my decision public, is to reach out to the family and explain my decision, the reasons for it. And they said, had we ever imagined or known that this would have happened, we would have never called the police. And if anybody thinks that way in this state, which they do, then it's incumbent on us to challenge our conventional wisdom of what we're doing. And this is what this bill does. It is a challenge to us to say, are we doing everything possibly that we can? Is this the right standard? It may be the right standard. Or should there be a change? But let's go through this process and have this conversation and ask the tough questions to ourselves. Because we want a state where people call the police when so many do because they need help. And the police do a tremendous job on so many circumstances that we never hear about. And we never hear about. Vermont State Police does an excellent job for the people of the state of Vermont, as do many other departments. But it's those cases that folks, whether it's parents with a child who may have a disability, who may react differently to authority than others may, is being culturally competent. And we're asking the police to do a tremendous amount, so we have to make sure that we're giving them the resources to be successful in these encounters, to successfully de-escalate incredibly complex and tense situations. So when we talk about how we police and how we interact with the people of the state of Vermont, nobody wants these outcomes where there is the use of lethal force. Nobody wants that. I think we can all agree to that. Sometimes they are going to be necessary, and I want to be clear about that too. There was a case, I believe, in Windsor County where an individual fired shots at the police and essentially put a gun to his pregnant girlfriend's head. Hostage situation. We asked the police to respond to that. They did, and they did so appropriately and courageously. We were that justified. And these are incredibly dynamic situations where I think if we can have this conversation to challenge ourselves, and it should not just be law enforcement having the conversation, we need stakeholders from everybody at the table, including mostly the mental health advocates, folks with disabilities, making sure that we have everybody who interacts with the police and folks who come from marginalized communities, folks from communities of color, because the way we're policing today is not the way we've policed the last 20 years. Vermont has an opportunity to lead. And so I fully support exploring this conversation, looking at California, talking with the lawyers in California, understanding what's working, being very clear that words matter here and they're not yet defined. And when you're talking about legal standards, definitions matter. And training matters and resources matter. So my ask is that there is a working group convened that is not just law enforcement, that is wider, that has all the stakeholders involved, and we work with the legislature to address this issue and to really scrutinize how we're doing business. I'm fully confident in the decisions I've made in terms of the current legal standard. I go back to that Fulbright case because I think it was different. I'm not sure the police had to go into his apartment that day, but they did. And I'm not going to second guess that. And once they're in, you're looking for me at those last few seconds of what happens. And Commissioner Sherling is absolutely right when he talks about, and I'll perhaps be more bored than Commissioner Sherling, this question of, we have a fundamental question to ask. Should we be calling the police to respond to mental health crises? And when nobody else is, have we done everything we can to provide enough training and resources to the police to address complex, dynamic situations in seconds? And when you have lawyers come in after the fact to make that review, we are looking at those seconds. And perhaps by expanding it, we would come to a different conclusion. I don't know, but I'm open to the conversation. I'm open to exploring things, to looking at this, because this is too important for anybody in this state to be fearful that an interaction with the police would end up violently, and that, as Representative Donahue said, that the public has trust and confidence in how the state lawyers review it. And I just would reiterate the complexities involved here. This is difficult stuff. These are hard conversations. This should not be a rush, that this should be methodical, deliberate, and that we really need to dig into this. So we are grateful that you are holding this hearing. I'm grateful for Representative Donahue's leadership. I'm grateful for the police. I'm grateful that Colonel Birmingham's in the room today. I'm grateful for his leadership. We've had a lot of conversations about this. People want to do the right thing. and it's not always easy to challenge our conventional thinking and to say, could we be doing things differently? That's what I view this bill as a challenge to us. Not to point out who's doing something wrong, but to point to perhaps say we can do things better and to increase not only the public safety, but the public trust in our state towards law enforcement. And I include myself in that as somebody who's made these decisions. Thank you.
Thank you for your perspective. You had mentioned earlier about, you know, you investigate a lot of shootings, officer shootings, and you may find them, they did everything by the book, by the law, what have you, they were justified. But it's still a shooting that we all would have liked to avoid. What do you do with what you learned when that investigation, what do you do with that information that maybe could have prevented it next time, if there's a way to do that?
I think it's a great question. You know, I understand your question, Representative Harrison, that while things may be justified legally, are there trends that we're seeing that would go to a call for different types of training or advocacy, and we haven't done that. And perhaps we should. I would say that the thread that is in almost all these cases is mental illness. That goes to training, that goes to de-escalation. And that is the threat through that. I also want to say from the police, these are incredibly dangerous situations, and they exercise incredible restraint, in my opinion.
I don't question that. They have seconds, if even that much time, to make a life or death situation or decision. But if I could also go back to California, and they changed their standard from what I am gleaning today, do they have any information that suggests better outcomes, or is it too early?
It's too early. I was on a panel with one of the lawyers in the AGs who's, I think, in charge of drafting and implementing this. And that's the individual who has, when you come to Vermont, or at least get on the phone and talk to us, because I think there's a process that they're going through right now in terms of the implementation of the law, and I'm not quite clear what that is. But the short answer is, it's too soon. They did change their standard. Commissioner Sherling's right. It is a different standard than what we would use. One of the standards, you had this question, which I'm not sure I support, but could be changed. It changes it from a reasonable person standard to a reasonable officer standard. I think that's complicated. And it goes into, this is just about the use of deadly force, where it's necessary to defend against imminent threat of death or serious bodily injury. I don't think necessary has been defined. And I'm sounding like a real lawyer here, but that is complicated because it's based on facts and it's going to be based on courts interpreting that. And there are real policy questions, too, about if it is just necessary to defend against imminent threat of death or serious bodily injury, what are we doing with an individual who may be suicidal? Not a threat to public safety, but a threat to themselves. What are we asking as policymakers for the police to do? What are we doing when somebody flees? Are we giving chase or not giving chase? What if there's an arrest warrant? Are we disregarding their arrest warrant? Think of the case of Winooski. Young man ran. One officer gave chase. Ended up in a deadly use of force. Other officers did not give chase. What was the policy? Should there be a policy to give chase? Then you deal with the what ifs. If something bad is going to happen, if you don't give chase from the police, is public safety at risk? Was it necessary? And there are no easy answers. And it is easier for lawyers after the fact to do that review. It's incredibly hard for that police officer to make that split second decision on the scene. And so when we talk about the training, when we talk about those definitions, we need to be really clear about what the law is if it changes, so the training is equally clear. But I think this is a conversation that we need to have, and it needs to be inclusive of everybody, because I think the public trust issue is real, because I've had the conversations with parents. And that's not a commentary on law enforcement. It's an acknowledgement of the complexities that exist in our communities and the struggles that parents and families are dealing with. And we've asked the police to step in and deal with this a lot. We need to be fair to the police too on this. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much.
So, Bor Yang, we would love to have you come and share your perspective with us.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.
I'm going to keep my comments very brief today, but I would like to introduce the Human Rights Commission to those of you who are not familiar with it, and sort of just talk about why we're here today and what our interest is. So the Human Rights Commission is a state entity, and we investigate claims of discrimination in three primary areas: housing, state government employment, and places of public accommodations. And places of public accommodations include any place that provides any sort of services or benefits to the general public. And that is a very broad definition. Of course, that includes all of our businesses and so forth, but it also includes law enforcement and the benefits and services that they provide to the general public. Place of public accommodation includes roads. And so we would also be investigating things that happen with police stops on roads as well. And it also includes prisons. And so certainly, we think that this is an issue that is important, and I'm glad that these are the bills that have been introduced. And generally, I would say that the Human Rights Commission supports both bills. They are good, and they are progressive, and also one of the bills here, 464, takes into consideration cultural competency, and I think that's really important. There are two groups of people that are probably mostly at target here, and those are people with psychiatric disabilities and mental health issues, and the other group is particularly men of color. And it is absolutely true that the work of the police is very hard, but it is also true that there is a great disparity in the stops and in police practices and in the services and benefits that are provided to these two groups of people. And I think that that's really important to keep in mind. I did listen to the testimony that was provided beforehand. I think what seems to be missing currently is a conversation that includes advocates. I also think that while the idea of a working group is great, we do have a lot of existing working groups right now that could take on some of these issues. I don't necessarily think that it is necessary to wait for California to see what happens there for a few years before we decide whether we should do something as equally progressive. So I would encourage you not necessarily to do that. I think that currently, if there are conversations about use of force, that they entirely involve law enforcement. DOC working with, I think, public safety. Even the Department of Mental Health is a government entity. And so I would be, I guess my concern is that the conversation has not traditionally involved the people who are most impacted by force and by police practices. and that is a problem. And I see 464 as a bill that starts to change that, and that is something that the human rights would support. Currently, the bill 464 has data being sent to the executive director of racial equity, and my only concern about that is that we're missing the piece about psychiatric disabilities and people with mental health issues. So I would encourage that if you move forward on 464, that we consider having another entity receive that information as well, unless we are ready to expand the work of the racial equity executive director, which I would not necessarily encourage us to do. Also, under 464, we've asked that data be collected in regards to age, gender, and the race of the driver, but I think it's also important to be able to collect whether that driver has a disability, whether it be physical or psychiatric or mental health or anything else. So those would be my primary changes to that statute, to that bill. And I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you.
Or I was wondering if, thank you for your testimony, by the way, and thank you for talking about 464. I was wondering if you wouldn't mind delving in a bit more into 808 and why you are in support of that.
Yeah, so I want to be fair that the Human Rights Commission doesn't have jurisdiction to necessarily review police shootings or use of force unless someone files a complaint at the Human Rights Commission. We have not had such an opportunity to investigate such a claim, but certainly we have are concerned. We've certainly heard of some of the stories that were even mentioned earlier, and some of the concerns from community members who have said, I should not have called the police. I was calling the police to help my husband. I should not have called the police because they, in fact, killed him. And I do think that that is a human rights issue. And generally, I think that when we have a bill that is progressive and looking forward, when we have a bill that is willing to make a change that might be more proactive in this regard, I think it's helpful. The only thing that I would suggest that H.808 take into consideration is what I find in H.464, which is a group of individuals who are also going to be looking at the standard and reviewing the standard and taking into consideration cultural competency. And so if H.808 goes forward, I would encourage that we borrow some of the language from 464, particularly in terms of the group of persons who are tasked to create those standards. Here in H.808, you have the law, the standards already, but you can have a group in place to review that. And to also review what's happening in California, if that's the concern. So if you move forward on 808, the group would be useful in reviewing those policies and making recommendations in the next legislative session.
I heard you say that if there was a working group constituted as part of this work, that there might be existing bodies who would be well suited to do that. Did I hear you or mishear you?
You did mishear me. I mean, we have the training council, we have the Human Rights Commission, obviously, but we have the Racial Disparities Panel. We have I always hesitate to even list any of those names because usually you seek the permission of those groups before you would identify them. So I would say that yes, there are already some bodies that are tasked with fair and impartial policing and tasked with looking at disparities and so forth. So yes, that possibility exists that those groups already are here and could do some of this work and review this. Yeah.
And do you think, just to your point, I don't want to think about this, but about individual groups, because I hear your point, but I guess one of my questions about any of those groups would be, to your point about making sure the voices of impacted groups are part of the, maybe that's a question for later day, if there's one or more of those groups that's better suited for that.
I think that's a great question. I think oftentimes the groups that we create are entities or agencies, and they're governed So obviously, I'm working for the Human Rights Commission, but I also want to be respectful of the fact that we are not the voice of all people in the state of Vermont. And we're not the voice of people with, and we're not a great voice for people with disabilities, no more than we are a great voice for all people of color. And I certainly think that there are many community groups that are missing from those as well. So if you were interested in passing the work here onto an existing group, I would suggest that we add some community members to that. Yeah, and I'd be happy to reach out to some of those community groups. Yeah.
Tom and then Rob.
You mentioned a story about a wife calling the police and her husband ended up, I'm not sure how, but ended up dead anyway, but the whole thing, just wondering what some of the details might have been that led to that.
Yeah, I don't know, we didn't investigate it. I do also recall the gentleman that died at Montpelier High School when he was shot down by multiple people, and he ended up having just a BB gun or not a real gun. I don't know the details, we didn't investigate those cases. I don't want to suggest that those were unlawful use of force or not lawful use of force. I think what I heard is, what I'm trying to express here, is that there is a real concern from community members about the use of force, and most of those concerns come from people with psychiatric disabilities, and they come from people of color. And I think that's just an important voice that needs to be heard here.
So. Thank you. You referred a couple times in your testimony, and I looked at cultural competencies, or in other words, this cross-cultural awareness. What does that mean to you?
Sure. Yeah. It means, it can be very difficult to explain, but for someone to have cultural competency, it means that they have the knowledge and expertise and experience working with different groups of people coming from different backgrounds. And they understand that there is a difference in how people act and react and behave, and that sometimes we have to adjust our policies and our practices accordingly. So it changes, cultural competency changes depending on the context. So for example, for our legislators to have cultural competency, it might mean that you are respectful of service animals and assistance animals. It might mean that you're respectful of interpreters and that you understand also that some of the people that you need to hear from may not be available from 9 to 5, and that's an understanding of cultural competency. Cultural competency in the hospital setting is also very different as well. And so cultural competency for the police could be very different. It might mean that the police have learned about what different psychiatric disabilities are. It might mean that they take classes about social work. It might mean that we give them more skills to identify when someone is behaving a certain way because they are a criminal, or they're behaving a certain way because of their psychiatric disabilities, and they are not harmful, and that they are not currently a threat. And so I imagine that I may not even be explaining this very well, but I imagine that social workers and doctors and people in the mental health field would be better able to explain what different psychiatric disabilities look like and why when someone reacts a certain way, it's a danger or it's not. But I would guess that our current law enforcement agencies are not equipped to deal and do not have cultural competency in that regard.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
I believe so. So I believe we have Cindy Taylor Patch and Drew Bloom from the Criminal Justice Training Council, and would love to have you come and share a little information about the landscape around training currently.
Good afternoon. Thank you. As she said, I'm Cindy Taylor Patch. I'm the Director of Training for the Vermont Criminal Justice Training Council, and that means that I oversee and supervise the Vermont Police Academy's basic training and in-service programs. To tell you a little bit about myself, I've been at the Academy since about 2003, and was involved a little bit prior, but full-time since 2003, so have been there for a long period of time and seen a lot of change over the years. Prior to my work in law enforcement, I was a crisis screener. I did mental health crisis response work for the Counseling Service of Addison County for the Rutland Mental Health and Rutland Regional Medical Center. I've worked in an inpatient psychiatric facility and done crisis work over the phone, face-to-face, consulted with the police on mental health crisis response, and I train officers in the same. So I can certainly answer any questions that you have about that training. I know Sheriff Keith Clark was mentioned earlier, and he and I worked together for a long time in the developing of curriculum and teaching officers on crisis response. Our curriculum on mental health was established by the Act 80 Commission. Some of you may recall hearing about that over the years. And it included people from various backgrounds, people in the treatment side of things, consumers of mental health services, law enforcement. It was a multidisciplinary group of folks, advocates, activists, people with very serious lived experience, everybody coming together to establish the curriculum that we teach from. I also sit on the Mental Health Crisis Response Commission, which was established much through the support of Representative Donahue and sits with the AG's office. And there's a number of members of that commission in the room. But essentially, if you're not familiar with the commission, it is a group of individuals, some of law enforcement, some from advocacy organizations, some with lived experience, who hears cases like the Phil Brennan case, where someone experiences death or serious bodily injury from police where they have a mental health issue. And we're going to continue to review those types of cases. So we review them to see what we can learn, not just from the law enforcement response, but from various aspects of their life. You know, what's the role of mental health in their services in their life, housing services, you know, sort of looking at the full gamut and trying to glean what we can that can be helpful from multiple services to bring back to you all what we can gather from that. Before I talk about basic training, I just want to give you an overview of what that looks like for folks who aren't familiar. For basic training for level 3 certified officers in Vermont, they're going to receive about 800 hours of training on various topics. And one of the things that they receive in their very first week of training is a block of training from myself and from law enforcement officers about foundations in policing. And I give them this booklet called The Nobility of Policing, Guardians of Democracy. And we have a very lengthy conversation, but just to give you an idea, we really emphasize one page in here, I'll read really quickly, is critical responsibilities. And the critical responsibilities of a police officer to preserve freedom and uphold democracy, to uphold the law, to ensure justice, to protect life, and to keep the peace. And we set that tone right away in our program because we believe in it wholeheartedly, and everything else that they're going to learn in our program, that needs to be at its base. So as part of that, you know, obviously we cover all different types of law and all different types of topics and situations, but some of the things that you're talking about today, just to give you an idea, recruits are going to receive about 120 hours of use of force and firearms training. That's both classroom and hands-on and scenario-based training. So 120 hours, it's pretty significant because we take it and take that responsibility very seriously. They also receive 16 hours of interpersonal communication skills, mental health training, and communication skills are certainly part of that. As I mentioned, that mental health training was developed by a statewide commission of multiple stakeholders from multiple backgrounds. They also receive 8 hours of training on fair and impartial policing and hate crimes. So the fair and impartial policing curriculum that we teach at the Academy is based on a model that's used nationally that was pushed out pretty heavily by the Bureau of Justice Assistance. And we've established a committee of various stakeholders, some law enforcement and some advocacy organizations. I've asked them to come together to advise us and guide us on the mandatory training that we have related to fair and impartial policing going forward. So what are we teaching in basic and what are we teaching every other year after graduation is all guided by both law enforcement and stakeholders in the, from the community. The hate crimes curriculum is taught by Julio Thompson. He's chief of the Civil Rights Division for the Attorney General's Office, and folks probably know him. He's the lead instructor for our hate crimes training. He teaches also with Amy Farr, who's the victim's advocate from his office, and Julia Torti from the U.S. Attorney General's Office. So we're certainly not doing any of this training in hiding or in a vacuum. It's very, multiple people involved, both in its development and delivery. In the mental health training that I mentioned before, I make a point to make sure that we also have a person with lived experience who comes in and talks about their interactions with police. When have they in their life been in crisis? And what worked for them and what didn't work for them as far as to help resolve that? So we have them there in the classroom spending time with officers, giving the good and the bad, what helped me, what didn't help me. And that's been a very powerful part of our curriculum that I feel really strongly about. Also, in addition, I mentioned, we talk about the foundation. So we spend 16 hours over the course of our curriculum really specifically targeting ethics, ideas about democracy, police legitimacy, community perceptions of our role, and what it means to be a leader in law enforcement or in your community as a law enforcement officer. And those, because of the way we run our curriculum, because I work closely with people who teach use of force and I work closely with people who teach patrol tactics, they know what my expectations are around these issues. It's not just me going in there and talking about this stuff, but they understand and believe and buy into the fact that they're also carrying the same messaging out in their curriculum wherever they possibly can. I think sometimes there's a perception that we teach topics in silos, and that's certainly not the case. Our training is always very integrated. It's really important to us that people see the complexities and how things apply to different situations. So scenario-based training is very important to us, something that we're trying to expand. Because we hear from recruits and officers in the field that it's one of the ways that they learn the best, actually get to try things in a scenario that's as close to real life as we can get. And those scenarios involve everything from criminal law, communication skills, use of force. They're all over the place assessing various types of skills. So nothing is in a silo, everything kind of integrates together. As far as oversight of the training that we deliver, it depends on the topic, but we have obviously the Criminal Justice Training Council being the ultimate level of oversight. We also have a variety of committees who provide input on our training. So I mentioned the Fair and Impartial Policing Training Committee that's advising that, and we have others as well. We have proposed significant expansion to our basic training program. We want to add more opportunity for scenario-based training. We've received input from new recruits, officers on the road, their supervisors, agency executives, all over the state who support an increased training around use of force, fair and impartial policing, de-escalation techniques. We have the knowledge and the expertise to offer more training on those things. What we don't have are the resources to expand the basic training program. It's not funded. And so that's really where we stand. We are ready to go. We have support. We don't have the money. So that's one thing I would just ask you to keep in mind as we're trying to work through this. I hear what I think where these bills are coming from, what the concerns are. I really, truly value the concerns. I hear you. And I definitely am on board. I'm mentally, I know my staff, my adjunct faculty are in the right place. They want more training on these issues, but they need to be funded.
Thank you.
Thank you for your help getting us to understand the training that goes on now. Would you envision the 4-hour requirement in H-464 to be in addition to the 800, or are you hours that you currently do for level 3 law enforcement, or is most of this covered already?
So I think I would need more detail as far as what folks are wanting to see in that 4 hours. We usually build training around objectives rather than time frames. So what are the objectives that we're trying to achieve? What do stakeholders and subject matter experts agree are the objectives? How long is it going to take us to get there? So we tend not to set a time limit, but rather looking at what do we want to accomplish. And they may be things that we are already accomplishing in basic training. There may be new concepts. We have a lot of methods for getting in service training or training bulletins or other things to get word out to people. So it really would depend on sort of doing a deeper dive of what that would look like and what folks wanted to see and how we would deliver.
You also mentioned that you currently have 8 hours devoted to fair and impartial.
Partial policing and hate crimes.
Okay. How does that compare to other states? Are we doing less? Are we doing more? Are we doing about average?
That's a good question. I would say in states that I'm aware of, we've been a little better. We've been a little bit more advanced, I think, in getting out in front of some things than some other states have. I'm sure, you know, there are others who do more, but we've been doing pretty well on that topic and pretty advanced, I think, in our thinking about how we approach our partial policing training.
Thank you.
And as far as the mandatory training, I'm not aware of anybody that's doing that, but there may be somebody I haven't heard of yet.
Thank you for walking us through the council's training program. What is your process for reviewing and updating your training program so it's as relevant and as effective as possible?
Yes, I'm really glad that you asked that question. We are constantly evolving. So every single class that we do, we have adjunct faculty who are people that are working out in the community. They're active practitioners. And as they bring up ideas or new ways of doing things or problems that they run into and want to try something different, we have teams of instructors who discuss what could we do to change things, what could we do to update. We're always researching best practice, reaching out to organizations like IACP and IADLIS, which is the International Association of Directors of Law Enforcement Standards and Training. You know, we're aware of a lot of think tank groups that have already findings on these issues, and we look at everything and we take it all into consideration and say, you know, what's best for the state of Vermont on this issue? Because sometimes the best in some places might not fit Vermont given our demographics, our geography, our populations. So we look at them in the context of Vermont and what makes the most sense for us, and we adjust as needed. But it's never something where it's stagnant. Things are always being reviewed and changing.
Thank you.
Hi, it's good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Thank you for the testimony. So we heard earlier about the importance of training, and we've also heard earlier that the word necessary doesn't quite have a definition yet in this context. And I was wondering if you have an opinion as to whether or not it would be challenging or not challenging to change around the curriculum for use of force training when the language in this statute is causing some changes.
I can tell you that I think depending on what happens, there certainly could be some extreme need to change training. And I think that Director of Administration Drew Bloom is going to talk specifically about that in a lot more detail, so I'll let him do that. But certainly would bring some challenges.
Thanks.
Hi, thanks. I'm wondering if you could fill me in on how any bias training, implicit bias training, is part of the work.
Yes.
So is it moved into some of these other units you've talked about, or is there a separate training on that?
It's sort of a separate training, but it relates to other things. It's the fair and impartial policing curriculum that is completely based on the concept of understanding implicit bias. And so we spend a fair amount of time in there explaining what that is to get people to open up their mind about what bias means. People have bias for the word bias, and they can get really offended right out of the gate to hear that concept. But when we present it in a way that helps people wrap their mind around ways that they might be biased that they don't even recognize. And it could be to anything, right? I mean, we talk about anything from race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender, poverty, I mean, you name it, and how folks can have bias that they may not even have ever contemplated, and try to get them to open up their mind to that idea. And we really also promote the idea of contact theory, of, you know, find out who's in your community and get to know the different groups that are in your community. Do outreach, talk to them. There's a lot of advantages to that for multiple reasons. So those are all things that we talk about in that fair and impartial policing curriculum. And how important it is to develop relationships of public trust. I think sometimes patrol officers can have a feeling that that's something that's out of their control. That's just for their chief or sheriff or, you know, colonel to worry about. And we talk right out of the gate in basic training that they're part of that process. You know, they're the ones who are out there facing the community every day and have an ability to establish relationships of trust on a daily basis. So get out there, meet people in your community, develop positive relationships with them so they feel like they're able to trust you. And that's it, yeah, completely within that curriculum. And we touch on other places where we can, and it's also what we're looking to expand if we could possibly get the funding to expand the program.
Thank you. Did I hear you say correctly that they get about 800 hours of training initially? And out of that 800 hours, how much of it, if you had to pick a number, would you say would be dedicated towards de-escalation in dealing with mental health scenarios?
So that's part of the proposal for expansion. It's not a lot right now. We get 8 hours that's really dedicated to a classroom lecture where we talk about a variety of things related to symptoms. So how do you recognize that you might be dealing with someone who has a mental health diagnosis? We talk about issues of stereotypes and stigma and why people might be hesitant to agree to go to a hospital, if that's what the officer is trying to suggest. We talk about how to use your local resources if you have an embedded social worker or if you have a local crisis team that might respond mobily to you. Unfortunately, that's kind of inconsistent around the state or inconsistent regarding the time of day when you can get mobile crisis response or not. But we talk about working with those folks when you can. And then we talk about some communication skills, how to position yourself in a room so you're not threatening, but you're still tactically safe, things to say, you know, just kind of walk people through that. So that's in and of itself is 8 hours, and we have another hour just on interpersonal communication skills. We also, and I know Director Bloom is going to talk about this in a moment, we also heavily emphasize de-escalation techniques within our use of force training program, and he's going to talk about that in a moment.
So we have only a limited amount of time left, and we do want to make sure that we get to Drew's testimony. Is that okay? Did you have a question on this? Okay, great. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. Everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
Thank you for having this discussion, and thank you for inviting us all here today to talk about these pieces of legislation. And please forgive me if I'm not the most eloquent speaker. I've never been accused of being the most eloquent speaker in a room, and I've certainly never been accused of being the smartest person in the room, even when I'm in a room by myself. So I'll do the best I can to get through this and just give you a little bit of a snapshot of our training at the Academy and some perspectives specific to use of force. So I've been a law enforcement officer in Vermont for 29 and a half years. This is a really long time. And it's a long time that I've taken that responsibility very seriously and have been dedicated as a public servant to the people of the state who are very near and dear to my heart. I've had a lot of great opportunities throughout my career to work in a whole myriad of different aspects of this job, serving in numerous capacities. But prior to coming to the Academy, I've been part of their adjunct staff since the early 1990s, and I've been teaching police use of force since 1992, and I've been teaching men, women, and children self-defense and martial arts for over 30 years, and I've been doing that for my entire life, which is not only teaching people how to defend themselves and protect themselves in the moment in a physical situation, but also to do things ethically and morally and to defend themselves properly so that there's no adverse consequence. And I do the same thing with law enforcement officers, and I've had the opportunity to teach police and law enforcement, not only in Vermont, but throughout the United States, at national and international conferences, and I've been invited to instruct and teach use of force in other countries as well. And it's something that I've done for a very long time, and I take that responsibility very seriously. In policing, in my opinion, there are no two greater areas of liability and no two greater areas of safety to the public and safety to our officers other than use of force in driving cars. Because when it comes to either one of those things, whether it's driving a police vehicle or driving your own car or use of force, if you make a mistake, it can never be fixed. It can never be undone. And that is the utmost responsibility. It can never be undone. It can't be amended. It can't be changed. You can't go back and fix it. Now, in other mistakes that you make in policing, fortunately you can. If you write the wrong amount of money on a traffic ticket because you screw up the fine and you didn't get it right, you can amend the ticket. If you put the wrong charge in an affidavit, the state's attorney can change their information and they can do a different charge. Those things can be fixed. If you make a mistake diagramming a crash scene, you can go back and you can amend it and you can say, yeah, I screwed up and I made that mistake. When it comes to use of force and operating a vehicle, those things can't be undone, they can't be fixed. And because of that, when I instruct officers, either as end-level users of use of force or instructors or senior instructors, which are instructor trainers, It is their responsibility to make sure that they do not error, that they do not err when they're using force. And it must be ethical, it must be judicious, and of course it must be reasonable, and it must be lawful. And even 99% right is still 100% wrong, and we can't afford that. So I just want to let you know that the Academy takes this responsibility very seriously. And when I think back to what we used to teach nationwide and in the state 20 years ago, 25 years ago, and how it has evolved and how it is constantly evolving, I'm so grateful for that. I think it's a very, very good thing. And sometimes to evolve is a little bit scary, isn't it? And I would submit to you that in order to evolve, you have to become vulnerable. And that means you have to let go of some of the things that you're used to. And sometimes that's you have to sacrifice a little bit of ego when it comes to that. And I can tell you that at the Academy, that's not something that we're afraid to do. We do it all the time. And we've done it over and over and over, not just in Vermont, but throughout this country, because I'm very in tune with what happens in other jurisdictions throughout the country, because I'm in contact with men and women who teach these things to their law enforcement. So I just wanted to lay a little bit of foundation by giving you that background. Now, prior to 2018, there was no mandate in Vermont that after basic training at the police academy, law enforcement officers received any subsequent use of force training when they went back to their agencies, other than firearms. They had to qualify with their firearm, and they still do every year at a minimum level, but there was zero requirement relative to having in-service use of force training. Now, fortunately, because we've got about 125 instructors certified in the state that are actively working at these different agencies, they provide that training. And most departments did a really good job, and they continue to do a really good job of providing that in-service training to their personnel on an annual basis, which covers all sorts of different aspects of our program and what we certify them to do. But we recognized at the council that there were a lot of agencies that didn't live up to these standards and these recommended best practices. So we changed our administrative rules, the council rules. And one of the things that we did when we renovated the rules, which hadn't been done in a number of years, was we put in there a requirement that every law enforcement officer, in order to remain certified as such, must have a minimum of 4 hours a year in use of force refresher training. So, in my view, is that enough? It's not, but it's a start, and it's better than nothing, and it's at least getting a foot in the door. So that's something that we now have put into place since 2018, and I'm really happy about that. When it comes to use of force in general in the United States and in this country's territories, use of force has always been governed by the judiciary and the community's needs. And that's where policy comes from. It comes from court decisions, it comes from cases in U.S. District Court, it comes from the U.S. Supreme Court and our own Vermont Supreme Court, in addition to what the community's needs are. And that's how use of force policies are developed. Now, there's a lot of recommended best practices, and we have met or exceeded those in Vermont. And I'm very proud of our program here, because as I have traveled around the country and worked with instructors, worked with law enforcement officers in other communities, and I brought some of our training there, I can't tell you how many times I've gotten done with a training in just an academic classroom environment, and I've had use of force instructors from other states. Most recently, I was at the Pennsylvania Game Commission teaching use of force instructors for game wardens in Pennsylvania, and many of those instructors came up to me and they said, gee, can I get a copy of your program? Can I get a copy of that? Because this is some really good stuff. And because of that, that serves as a litmus test to me when I travel around the country and I hear these accolades of our program. There's a tremendous amount of personal pride in that for me. So getting back to my point about the courts, when Commissioner Sherling spoke, he talked about Graham, which has been that nearly 50-year test when it comes to determining the reasonableness when assessing a use of force case, when assessing a force situation. And the reason, in my opinion, that that's lasted for as long as it has is because the U.S. Supreme Court gave us some really good tools to calculate reasonableness when you're looking to assess whether or not a law enforcement officer's actions were reasonable when they applied force. And force, as far as the Supreme Court is concerned, is all governed, like the commissioner said, under the Fourth Amendment, which protects free citizens in this country from unreasonable search and seizure. And any time, any use of force, even something as minute as detaining someone and saying, let me see your driver's license, as far as the Supreme Court is concerned, that's a use of force. And that is a seizure under the Fourth Amendment. And therefore, it is of the paramount importance that is administered judiciously and fairly and under the law. So the tools that the court gave us was, the U.S. Supreme Court said, we're going to give you a four-prong test when we're assessing reasonableness, when we're looking at whether or not an officer's actions were reasonable. We're going to look at the severity of the crime, the severity of the situation, which is basically, how big a deal is it? What's the officer there for? What are they lawfully present for? What do they have? Do they have a legal right to be there? Do they have a legal right to remain there? And has that right evaporated? And if not, what are they there for? How big a deal is it? Then the court said, we're going to look at whether or not the person or subjects involved pose an immediate threat to that officer or to someone else, which means right now. Immediate means right now. And I want you to keep that in mind, because when we talk about right now, the luxury that you don't have necessarily is time. And that becomes pretty critical when you start talking about officers having to make split-second decisions. Split-second decisions that can get them hurt, that can get someone else hurt, or that can ruin their career, that could be one fraction of a second away from either a lawful use of force or them being indicted or charged with simple assault or aggravated assault or God forbid, homicide. So that's something that is a heavy responsibility. And when I stand in front of the classroom, especially in basic training, never mind the instructor level, when I'm talking about officers that are veterans officers and now they want to become instructors and they want to further their career, and I see the look on these young men and women's faces in the classroom for the first time when I start talking about the legalities of reasonable application of force, and they realize for the first time that it's not like TV. And they realize that it's not like the movies. And you can see them slump down in their chairs. And you can see the looks of defeat on their face when they realize what they've really signed up for. And I ask them when they go to bed that night, when they put their heads down on their pillows, to really take a look internally to make sure that they're up for this challenge, because it is a tremendous burden for them. So getting back to the court's four-prong test, they're going to ask us, was there an immediate threat? Then they're going to want to know whether or not the person was actively resisting or attempting to evade capture, which is in that moment. And finally, they said, are the circumstances tense, uncertain, and rapidly evolving? Which again takes away time. But the court went a step further, and they said, we're not only going to look at that four-prong test every time we're assessing force and whether or not it was reasonable. They said, we're going to look at whether or not this force was reasonable based on another law enforcement officer of similar training and experience, whether or not they would look at what you did and say, yeah, that's okay. That may not necessarily have been what I would have done, but that's still reasonable. And they gave us some additional tools to do that. And we refer to those as perceptual factors, because it is impossible with any certainty to say in a given situation that if a suspect is doing this, an officer can always do that. You can speak in general terms and say, yeah, generally that is probably going to be okay. But it's going to require a whole lot more information, because everyone's perception is slightly different. So those perceptual factors that we try to consider when we're assessing reasonableness are things like age, size, gender, skill level of the officer, skill level of the other people involved, whether or not there was an injury or an exhaustion that occurred, whether or not an officer ended up on the ground in an uncontrolled situation, whether or not there were weapons involved, whether or not there was a close proximity to weapons involved, whether or not there were some special circumstances and knowledge that you knew about this person prior to dealing with that individual. We have to take all of those things into account when we're trying to determine that calculation of reasonableness. And then finally, you have to look at things like pre-attack behavior, pre-attack cues, all of those things that people will do under stress when their body is going into fight, flight, or freeze. And then those officers are trying to recognize these signs to quickly calculate in their mind what's about to happen here. And when something becomes tense, uncertain, and rapidly evolving, their plan A is out the window, their plan B is out the window, and now they have to make these split-second decisions, and they're thinking about the liabilities that are involved with that. Our own Vermont Supreme Court, back in 1993, echoed the Graham decision. And we've had that, legal decision here ever since, which we have continued to train to. I've also had the opportunity to bring our use of force training, particularly this block on reasonable application of force, to the Governor's Mental Health Commission, and have spoken to that group and have spoken with them about our training. And the response that I got from that group during this presentation was very, very favorable. And I think that group was impressed with the length that we go to train our officers to use force lawfully and properly in this country. And when it comes to deadly force, there's also an additional standard. And I don't teach firearms. I'm a firearms instructor. I teach all of everything leading up to firearms. And then we have a whole separate group of instructors that teach firearms out of range, and they teach deadly force. But as Director Patch said, we've got between just use of force and tactics, which is my shop, and with firearms, there's just about 120 hours that a basic recruit gets. And that is not including all of the hours that they get in patrol procedures, in criminal law, in motor vehicle law. And then eventually, our scenario-based training makes sure that they are able to weave all of these disciplines together so that they don't operate in silos, because they're all interconnected, because that's the goal. And that's the ultimate test, is that from a scenario-based perspective, can these officers, these men and women, graduate, and can they do the same thing out in the field? And that's the ultimate test. But there's a long path that has to be followed when you're not only teaching the academic portions of use of force, but the psychomotor skills, which is the physical stuff that you have to do, and that's what they learn in the gym. And that's done through various phases of teaching psychomotor skills learning to adults, and that gets a little complicated. It takes a lot of time. We spend a tremendous amount of time doing that. But getting back to the standard in Vermont for deadly force, we refer to this as AOJ, which is the deadly force triangle. A meaning ability, and then O for opportunity, and J meaning jeopardy. Which means in order for an officer to employ deadly force, all three walls of that triangle must exist, which means does the subject involved have the ability to cause serious bodily injury or death? Do they have the opportunity to do it? And is the jeopardy immediate? Is it happening right now? And if any of the walls of that triangle evaporate, it's not lawful. It's not a lawful use of force anymore. And that's been the standard that we've used for many, many years. And I think it continues, coupled with the Graham standard and with the standards echoed by our own Vermont Supreme Court, are very, very good standard. One of the other things I want to mention is use of force models. I'm not sure if you're familiar with what a use of force model is.
Can I ask a quick question?
I'm sorry, we're going to have to wrap it up soon, and so certainly whatever committee this goes to next, we'll certainly have you back.
So the ability, opportunity, jeopardy, that triangle, how is that, I don't mean to make this a leading question, but I guess it will be, how is that different than showing the necessity of the use of force? And those.
Well, I plan to get into that as I went down my laundry list of bullet points here. But if I'm gonna have to pull the pin on this, one of the things that I just want to leave you with today is that when we talk about words like least, minimum, necessary, it becomes very, very dangerous. It becomes very, very dangerous, and that's thin ice to tread on. Now, do we want to use the least amount of force? Absolutely, because de-escalation is coupled into everything we do. It's coupled into everything we do. And I teach officers from day one to sacrifice your ego to avoid conflict, because that is more important. And we talk about the four A's of defensive tactics, awareness. Avoidance is number two. And avoidance is not getting into struggles with people. It's not fighting with people. And then it's acceptance and taking action. But it is in everything that we do. We ask, we advise, we order in that order, and we try to always use those communication skills. But when there is no time, and the time has evaporated, that's when you gotta make those split second decisions, which it's very easy to watch a video on YouTube or see something on the news and look at something that's fairly horrible and say, wow, that looks really bad. Okay, click on to the next video. But when you're in that circumstance and when you're experiencing the human emotion and drama when you're facing what you're perceiving to be a potentially deadly malignant threat, that's really something else. And having been in those situations personally myself, I can tell you that you fall back on your training because you do not have time to think. It's like driving a car. I would submit to you that you're all probably would agree that you're better drivers now than when you got your learner's permits. I can't imagine any of you would admit that you're not. But what does your foot do when the car in front of you, the brake lights come on? Your right foot goes from that gas pedal to that brake, and you don't do it with any thought, because if you had to think about it, it's going to be too late. And that's the goal with law enforcement when we train for use of force. It must be that fast. And that's why good training and quality training becomes so important. But getting back to your question about necessity, we would love to always use force that is the least, the minimum, only force that is necessary. But the problem with that is, from my perspective, is that you never know what that is, because in order to know what that is, you have to get inside someone's head. So you have to base your decisions on circumstances known to you at the time of that incident only. Based on all of those perceptual factors, you have to base it on that only. Because if someone is pointing a firearm at an officer and they say, I am going to kill you, the officer's perception is going to be, I'm about to lose my life. Or someone else is about to lose their life. This is a deadly force situation. But maybe all it's going to take is for that officer to say, put down the gun, and the person does it. Well, certainly then the least amount of force was a verbal command. The minimum amount of force was a verbal command. The only force that was necessary was a verbal command. But there's no way for the officer to know that. And conversely, if the officer thinks that they have to take the time to say, I'm a law enforcement officer, and if you don't drop the gun, I'm going to have to use deadly force, well, what if it really is, if it is the person's intent? Well, now that officer's lost their life, or the life of someone else that they're trying to defend. So that's what I see as a problem when you get into words like least minimum or necessary versus reasonable officer perception. I've got more, but I know you want me. You're going to give me the hook, so.
You answered one of my questions about basically slowing down an officer response in a situation, in a dangerous situation, I brought this up many times, and a lot of people in here know that this stuff is kind of near and dear to my heart, and it may seem kind of funny, but I kind of look at all law enforcement now as my son, because my son is in law enforcement and has been in those situations. And I would hate to think if he had to stop and think for that extra second, because I know things can happen in that second. And his job, and maybe your job too, is time can be dangerous enough without having to react because of your training is going to be a lot more sensible than having to stop and think about what you're doing, in a sense. I know you're still thinking about what you're doing, but like you said, with the foot going from the gas pedal to the brake, I would rather have that skilled reaction than having to wait that extra time. You said you do use of force training outside of the state. And it sounds like it's a pretty valuable, I guess you could almost say Vermont export. And so it's something, I'm going to assume that the Vermont training that you do with use of force is something that's sought after.
It is.
Yeah. So that tells me that you're probably doing a pretty good job at what you do. And I mean, it's a valuable export, but it's more on the import side where it's going to be more valuable to your students. And I guess I want to commend the academy on that your use of force training is something that people want. And one of the academy's 800 hours.
Approximately for level three basic certification, which right. does not include the post basic training that they have to have before they can finally shoe up the door.
So that's 20 weeks. Is it 20 weeks?
16 weeks plus several weeks of post basic training after that.
Is that department specific training?
Yes, and it's relative to whether or not they, for instance, if their agency issues conductive electrical weapons, commonly referred to as a taser, then they'll come back and they'll get that specific training.
So I guess, and I don't remember what you were relating it to, but you talked about 10 years ago, 20 years ago, or something like that, how this training has changed. So has the hours changed? I mean, 30 years ago, was it 800 hours? You know, that type of thing? Or you may not know.
Yeah, I couldn't tell you exactly how long the academy was. When I went through, it was 14 weeks, and now it's 16 weeks. So it's increased just by 2 weeks. But we would really like to have that expansion if we have the funding for that expansion. And one of the things that the Training Advisory Committee concluded was that if we do have the expansion, if we're able to ever get there, we would increase our use of force training by 2 more days, which would be 16 more hours of training. And I think that would be fairly important. And I just wanted to echo one other thing that you mentioned when it comes to slowing down situations and teaching that de-escalation. You know, not only do we have very specific scenarios that officers are tested on during the use of force training where in order to pass, they have to de-escalate the situation. So it's not always an escalation of force, but they must de-escalate something that we want them to think is going to be a use of force, but in order to pass it, they have to recognize that it's not. But one other thing when it comes to de-escalation, because when you say that now, what do you think of? When you say de-escalation, people think that a law enforcement officer will be able to effectively communicate so that there's no conflict. And On its face, that's absolutely what de-escalation is. But here's the part of de-escalation that most people never think about, but I have to think about all the time as a trainer. And that's teaching officers when to recognize that you must de-escalate in the heat of the moment, but the fight's not done. Nobody ever thinks about that. So if an officer is right in the middle of a violent struggle, or someone's actively resisting, or they're being assaulted and they're trying to harm that officer or someone else, and in a split second, I may be able to strike that person with a baton. I may be able to strike them with an empty hand technique. I may be able to utilize a conductive electrical weapon on that person. But then in a fraction of the second, that person's behavior changes, and they're no longer being assaultive, but now they're just physically resisting being put in handcuffs. Well, I can't do what I could do a half a second ago, but I'm still fighting with them. And that, to me, is a very critical aspect of de-escalation that I would love to have more time to train, because the difference between a fraction of a second is a reasonable application of force and being indicted for an aggravated assault. And that, to me, is very serious water to tread.
Okay, so I have a question. Thank you. Thank you very much. So we're going to have to end it now. I apologize to the few witnesses that we haven't gotten to, but we certainly will get back to this topic. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.